going to ask that we all stand, please. said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way, you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am the Father. I'm in the Father, and the Father is in me. Or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Again, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. You may be seated. We've come to the celebration of life for Caleb Shepphard. We'll have a selection, scripture, prayer, another selection, the obituary read silently, a video presentation, special thoughts, reflections, selection, and a eulogy, acknowledgement, committal, and closing prayer. And we'll follow our program as printed.
In the precious to me. In the fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. Oh yes, you lift me up. In the fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. You lift me up. You are my strength, strength like no strength like no other. It reaches to me. It reaches to me. It reaches to me.
Testament. Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. The word of the Lord.
For we can find comfort in the word of the Lord. New Testament today will be found in Romans 8, verses 37 through 39. And it reads, yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us bow our hearts as we go before the throne of grace. God tells us in his word that he loves us so much that he sent his only son into the world to die. There's a love that we cannot be separated from. We seek that love today to comfort us. Father, we are so grateful and thankful today that nothing takes you by surprise, but you know all things. You are truly the Alpha and Omega. You are the beginning and the end. It is written, O Lord, that you knew each and every one of us before we were fashioned and formed in our mother's womb. You fashioned our days. And Father, as we are gathered round your throne today, there's a pain that's within our hearts that we can't understand. It's like a sting that only you can soothe. We deal with this last enemy, O Lord, the enemy of death. But you tell us in your word that we, Jesus has called us more than conquerors. He has overcame and he has given us his life. He said that in him was the life, and the life was the light of men. When there's darkness all around us, we know that Jesus has given us his light. And truly, he is the light of the world. Now we pray, Father, for the family today, for the loved ones. We pray, God, for your comfort. We pray for your peace. We pray for your strength upon them today. And even, Father, as this day passes, and when the crowd is diminished, we pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, that they will find joy in you. The joy of the Lord is truly our strength. And God, they need you today. Be their strength. Be their comforter. Be the great I am in their lives. We thank you today, Father. We bless you. We praise you, Father. Thank you for the life of Caleb. Thank you for the gift that you've allowed us to experience through him. We give you praise today. Be exalted in this service, and we may praise you for your mighty acts of love. We ask these and all blessings in Jesus' name. Amen.
I know that there were times in your life when the wheels, they seemed to turn, and uncertainties about your tomorrow seem to grow. One thing you should remember, and you should always know, that out of everyone who loves you, I love you the most. For I am just a prayer away. Call on my name with your heart, and I will hear every word you say. When you cry at night, I'll wipe your tears away. Just pray, my love, and I'll be there right away. You will never have to wonder about Just put your faith and trust in my care. I will always be there to hold you in my arms when you pray. Don't worry, yeah. I'll protect you from the storm. Out of everyone who loves you, yeah, I love you the most. I am just a prayer away. Call on my name with your heart. Yes, I'll hear. I said I am just. Jesus is just a prayer away. Call on the Master's name with your heart. I know he'll hear every word you say. When you cry at night, he'll wipe every tear away. Just pray, my love, and he'll be there right. Jesus will be there right away.
What a reminder that he's just a prayer away. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to read the obituary silently now. It's printed in the program. Now we'll have a video presentation.
Hang on to the world as it spins around. Just don't let the spin get you down. Things are moving fast. Hold on tight and you will last. Keep your self-respect, your manly pride. Just dry. Never mind your fears. Brighter days will soon be here. Take it from me, someday we'll all be free. Yeah.
tall. Hold your head up high.
Now we'll have special thoughts from the family. So I don't know who those persons are. I'm going to ask that they would come. There's a mic over here to my right. If you don't feel comfortable coming up here, that's fine. Yeah, they we'll let it down for you. Somebody hold it for you. There we go.
This is from my brother. April the 28th, 1999. My life was changed when Yolanda placed this handsome baby boy in my arms. Once we made eye contact, I fell in love. I knew at that moment, we had a king in the making. Looking into his eyes, I could see him saying, "That's my father." Once you came in my life, I knew I would be different. I had to adjust from raising my girls to now helping raise a man. Caleb and I loved horses. I remember a time I took him to an auction. I stepped out for a second, and he made a bid on one of the horses. Now y'all know who paid for that horse. But as you grew, you had your heart on other things. And hobbies. But one thing you held dear to your heart was music. I could never understand it, but your drive and your passion for it made me respected. Caleb, you was my everything. He wasn't just my grandson, but he was my son. It was a joy to watch you grow. And today, you got your wings. I just And just like you knew I had your back, now I know you got mine.
Thank you.
Oh, rest, my son. Papa loves you.
And the honor, I believe, completely designed by God Almighty to spend the last week of his living life with Caleb. He stayed in my house, and we had many, many conversations. And on the very Sunday after we got back from church, he was on Sunday the 22nd, okay? We were sitting there in the kitchen, I'm cooking. He's peeling potatoes, and we're having lots of deep conversations. And we were talking about, you know, life, and he wants to leave the streets, Mima. I want to get back to being Caleb Shepherd. I feel like the R5 name made me into someone very different. And I'm ready to go back to myself. So I guess it was maybe about 2 days before they cut all the, I call it crazy hair off. And then he went on that Sunday, went down to get his vaccination for the COVID. And we got back and was still talking in the kitchen, making pies and peeling potatoes he was. And I said, Caleb, you remember your favorite scripture? Probably no older than 9 years old, a little Christian private school he went to. First one you told me about was Psalms 121. I lift my eyes into the hills. I said, you remember that? He said, yeah, Mimo, I still remember that scripture. And it might be one of the few, but I still remember it. But we talked about that scripture, and then we went on to talk about, nothing can still separate him from the love of God. Not death. Not death. Not death can separate him from the love of God. Did you hear me? Not death. Not life. Not powers. Not principalities. Not angels. No power. The powers of Hollywood or whatever that is that they do when it rains could separate him from the love of God. We were sitting talking about that. And he said, now, Mima, I think I want to get some of these tattoos off, just some of them. And I said, oh, okay. I'll help you pay for it. And so he said, you know you always taught me the Lord accepts me as I am. You know that. I'm like, yes, I do remember that. So anyway, I just wanted to share that with everybody. And I had a lot to say here, but I'm not going to say all that. I want to say this, though. In my, I'll call it day one after the tragedy prayer, the Lord came to me as I was having a tremendous meltdown one morning at my 5 o'clock prayer, and he's let me know that Caleb is no longer confused. He's no longer stressed. He's no longer angry or trying to find himself. He is in the bosom of Christ Almighty. And then day two, I was washing the very jeans he wore to church on the Sunday, and I pulled out his driving license and little bank card and stuff and looked at the picture and just had another meltdown. Fell on my knees, and I'm all in tears, and the Lord says to me, who can take better care of him, me or you? I said, hands down, you, Lord. And then he said one more thing. Who can love him the most, me or you? Again, you, Lord. I'm like, this is like Peter. Lovest thou me more than thee? You know, I don't, it's just, God just got such a beautiful sense of humor. And nothing can separate the person who has truly given their heart and committed themselves to Jesus Christ and established a relationship with him. There is nothing that can separate you from that love. Okay? Sometimes you do feel alone. Sometimes you feel like you're going through something that's so heavy, it's so hard that no one else is going through it. But guess what? We all go through these things. We're going through similar stuff. There's nothing new under the sun. We all go through the same things. We just got to find out who is in charge of everything. And that's Jesus Christ himself. If you find out who's in charge of everything, then he'll give you, and you acknowledge him, he'll give you the directions to always know that he is present and accounted for. He is just as close as your very breath, and even nearer than your hands or your feet. That's who my God is, and that's who's got my grandson. And I so much thank him and praise him that he's in a very much better place. We love the Lord. My family does. And I'm sure all of you out there, if you don't, I pray to God you learn who he is. He will be with you always, even until the ends of the earth, no matter where you go. You cannot run from him. You can't hide from him. He knows everything. He knows your heart. If you would, think about giving your heart to him today. Amen.
My first nephew, Caleb more than a nephew to me. He was like my son. Me and my sister, most of y'all know, were single moms together at the same time. So we basically tag team raising our children. So Caleb meant so much to me. Him and my oldest were best friends forever. They would get in trouble together. They would make trouble together. They were the big boys of the family. And I'm gonna miss him so much. Unfortunately, we all here today, but we all here to honor my nephew, Caleb. And I want y'all today to never let him leave your hearts and always keep him in your mind, as we will also. Londa, Sierra, and Josh, I love you guys. And y'all know if y'all need me, I'm here.
Caleb was like my first child. I don't think I've ever loved a child as much as I loved him. I tried so hard to lead by example and show him something different, to the point where I felt like I failed him. Because I could have helped him more. I tried to show him something different. He was a legend. He's always going to be a legend in my eyes. I will always be his biggest fan. He will be loved and never forgotten. And y'all just keep our family in prayers.
Okay, I get under God, my family. My sister read a scripture for me, but nobody know my heart. I can put anything on paper, but my boy, that was my boy. I had surgery last month, and I called him up, and I said, Caleb, I said, Papa, get on that table, and don't get off that table. You got to take care of my girls. Take care of my wife, my three daughters, Tony, Sheba, Chris, Don. Now I'm telling Joshua, and then the Papa, you the man. You got to take care of my family. I love my grandson. Nobody know. I fought head and tooth for that boy, day in and day out. But I didn't understand him. My friends in the streets out there that know Papa, let this be an example for y'all. I look out in the audience and I see a lot of faces I know. They know me by Papa. If y'all need somebody to talk to, come to me. I'm there for y'all. Do I have y'all word as K5, R5 friends? If y'all got a problem, come and talk to me. Do I have this? I'm going to ask y'all once more time. Do I have y'all word as R5 that something happened? Y'all will come talk to me, because life is too short. And y'all know, everybody in the streets know that K5, you know, I know him as Caleb DeMarco Shepherd, my son. All that R5, K5, I ain't about that. He was my son. So if I can just have y'all promise, my pastor will be here for y'all. I got all kind of church members. You got a problem, talk to somebody. Because life is too short. I'm 70 years old. And I need somebody to talk to sometime myself. Ronald Ray, my church members. So if y'all got a problem, let's talk. Because everything can be worked out. Here you go, Nick. You want to talk?
I don't really know much to say. Like, me and Caleb, like, before my brothers came, like my mom said, we was that duo. Like, we got in trouble together. We did everything together. We ate, sleep, argued, and we ate dog food together. We ate soap together. Yeah, we burnt school down on accident. But, like, I don't know, like, and like everybody said, he loved music, and we started in middle school. We started a rock group. It was me and him, and we called it ABC, Another Bad Creation. Like he was the dude with the music, and I was just the singer. I ain't never really did none of it, so I just followed his lead. He'd just be like, "Man, come on, bro, stop being scared, man. Bro, we could do this." So New Boys came out, Rich Kids, all. That man love Rich Kids, bro. Let me tell you, that man love Rich Kids. Like, whenever school he talked about Caleb, boy, he swore that was him. Like, it was funny, but at the same time, like, I never knew for him to be a rapper. I always saw him as an artist. He loved, drawing was his thing and riding horses. We went to the farm with Papa one day, and we had a horse named Mandingo, and we was trying to stop it from running around the yard. And Papa told us to stand out and hold our arms out. And we was like, "Bro, we not finna do this. We about to get ran over." So he was like, "Just listen to me." So Caleb, you know, he came over. He smacked me back in my head. He was like, "Bro, come on, bro. Just get the horse." And next thing you know, the rope came and got him and just yanked him all the way down the aisle of the horse. And he like, "Bro, can I help you, bro?" I'm like, "Man, I don't even know what to do. What you want me to do?" Like, so I come out, I just jump out there, I start the horse, and then the horse just turned left and went in the barn. We got him, and he was like, "Bro, that took you long enough." So he just ran out the barn and jumped the fence, and we got in the truck, and we just waited. And that's when he was like, "Man, I don't know if I'm going to ride a horse again, bro." So 2 months later came by, and we had got another horse named Black Beauty, and he will always try to ride the horse without a saddle. I can't name how many times he jumped on it, and the horse was 6 feet taller than us. We like this high, and he just wanted to jump on it. There's it's not enough stories that I could tell you about Caleb, but nothing that y'all can read and hear on the internet is who Caleb was, because that man, he was a stand-up dude. To me, he was like my big cuz. Like, I'm the big cuz, but I called him little big cuz because he did big cuz stuff, and I was always proud of whatever he did. And I never got to see him like that since I left, and I always wanted to. So the last time I came down here, I made it a mission to come see him. Like, first day I touched down, I called Joshua. Where Caleb at, bro? He's like, man, I don't know, bro. You got to call him. Took his phone. I said, call Caleb. Called me. He said, what's up, bro? He was like, you thought he was talking to Joshua. I said, no, bro. Where are you at, man? Come on. Like, I'm here. Like, pull up, bro. He's like, all right, I'm coming. I stayed at my house all night. We stayed, me and John stayed till about like 1 o'clock in the morning. I ain't catch him. As soon as I left, they called me, was like, Caleb spent the night last night. All right, I'm on my way. Went back over there. I ain't catch him. They said he gonna come later on today. I was like, all right, I'm gonna sit there and wait again. Missed him again. I left. They was like, he just stopped by to come get his clothes. I was like, all right, I'm gonna call him. When you gonna come back, bro? He's like, I'm gonna be back there later on today. Another day go by. I'm going on my last day being here. There's like, that's not to tell me. Caleb gonna be at 2 o'clock today. I saw him. I said, all right. Caleb, whatever you do, bro, don't move. He was like, man, you gotta catch up with me, bro. I got things to do, bro. I gotta go to the studio. I said, I know. I said, if I have to come over there, bro, I will. I called him, and this is right in the same time that my little cousin got in trouble. And I ain't know what to do more when you walk through that door. The kid in me wanted to pick him up and just be like, bro, it's been forever. And I'm glad I could see you again. But at the same time, I was just happy to see him. And for that to know, tonight is going to be the last time I saw my cousin. I ain't going to be sad about it. I'm just happy I saw him again. But I love you forever, man. For sure.
I just want Caleb to know that I will miss you. You meant the world to me. You were my baby before I had my babies. I miss everything about you, from your slick comments to your beautiful smile. You're my biggest critic. You never wanted your big sister to settle for anything less than perfect, and I love that about you. I was your big sister, but you acted like a big brother. Alea's gonna miss your random calls. Hey, Uncle Baby. She loves you so much. I'll make sure Adonis knows how much of a goat you were. You said, dang, girl, you gave me my first niece and my first nephew. They're gonna get whatever from me. We fought like siblings, too, all the time, but I know nobody had my back more than you had my back. Thank you for loving me the way you did. Thank you for trusting my opinion for girl advice. Thank you for the random calls, and thank you for leaving something for us to listen to when we're missing you more than other days. Thank you for being unapologetically you. I'm loving you always. It's always up about you. I put parts on a board behind you. It's me and you forever. I love you so much.
Me and Caleb was close. Me and him used to joke around and run, and he used to play and try to play jokes on me. I mean, the last night I touched, he was like, you all watch these little cartoons. Why can't we watch some real TV?
My baby right now.
So, talk about you, but you ugly, bro. Me and him used to join each other. I'm going to miss him. He was what it took us. I looked up to him. I song, Prince of Gold. And he got there. I was one of his biggest fans.
Hello, everyone. I'm Yolanda's older sister, Toni. And I want to say, from one mother to another, that I love you so much. And you have so many people that support you and love you, and you're not going through this by yourself. Some days, it's going to seem so hard, and you might not even be able to get out the bed, walk, or talk. But it's okay. Nothing's ever wrong. Nothing. Not the way you feel, not the way you think, is ever wrong. I'm not gonna step and tell you that it gets greater later, because sometimes the later gets worse than the beginning. From one mother to another, I love you with everything in me. And I love my family, and they are here. No matter what, night or day, I'm a phone call away. I don't care if you just want to breathe over the phone. I'm a phone call away, and I love you so much. I love y'all.
I love you too.
I love you, too. I love you, Mom. I love you, Dad. I love you unconditionally. I love my nieces, my nephews. I love everyone. Just pray for our family, please.
Thank the family for the special thoughts. The program now calls for reflections, and what I'm going to ask is this. I'm going to ask, first of all, there are a number of us, obviously look at the number of people in this room, people that want to say something, but everybody cannot speak. Is that fair? Everybody cannot speak. So I'm going to ask, give me three people, and I'm going to ask those three persons to make a line right here and limit your comments to 2 minutes, please. Three people, if you desire to give reflections, and if you desire to do that, if you would do that, I'm going to ask you to come now and make a line right here, those three people. Once I see three people, I'll understand that they're that these are the persons who will make the reflections, and I'm going to ask that you limit your reflections to 2 minutes. Just one gentleman, hold on before you start. Where is the mic? Oh, you got it. Okay. All right. That's two. Is there one more? I wanted to make sure. All right, so I only see two people. So I'm assuming that's it. Oh, somebody else is coming from the rear. Okay, three persons. I see them right there. All right, thank you so much. That's number three. All right, just only three, please. Only three. One, two, and only three. All right, thank you. You can stay right there. That's fine.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Right. My name is Ramel. People call me Tiger. I've been in the state of Georgia for 9 years, and I've been cutting. Caleb's and Joshua was here for approximately 8 years. I knew them. The family, I love you. Y'all always supported me through thick and thin. And it ain't been no walk in no park in the state of Georgia for me. No, it hasn't. Y'all know me. I try to raise my son by myself in the state of Georgia, and I know what it's like, and I know what it's like for you, Mama, to lose your baby. He would always be your baby. You have children, protect them. This goes out to each and everybody in this room. You have children, protect them. These are our flesh, this is our blood. Protect these guys. Protect these young girls that's growing up. Protect them and love them with all your heart. Give it your all. Give it your all. No matter what you believe in, give it your all. Don't let nobody deter you from what you want. Go get it, and that's it. Ain't no bottom lines. It's 2021, and this year been going by hella fast. And it ain't wait for nobody. Believe it. Believe it. It ain't been no walk in no park. Everybody got been on a seesaw ride, and it's time to level this thing out. Level it out. Make sense of it all. Protect your all. Protect your children. Protect your family. Love each other. And keep going. God bless y'all.
Give the mic to her.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I just want to say to the family, I remember Caleb when he was a baby, when he was born, and I was away from the city for many years, but, you know, from time to time I would come and visit the family and see what was going on, and I'm grateful that I am a part of this family. So, you know, whenever there's a need, then I'm there. And so we should all be that way. When there's a need, you should be there for your friends. So know that I love you, and God will take care of you. He's going to give you that peace over time. Yolanda, just keep your eyes on the Lord. And everybody, keep showing that love. That love is the most important thing that we need in our lives. So love each other. Amen.
This day is so something, you know. I'm speaking on the guy I knew as Lil K. That's all I knew him about was Lil K. He came around, and it's so crazy because I'll be celebrating a year loss of my own son tomorrow. And I just remember what Lil K was when my son passed away. Lil K was out so fast. He came to me. He had a picture of my son. He had a frame. He got the picture. He put it in the frame. And not only did he have a picture for me, he made a song about my son. That was the coolest thing. So I'd been loved this guy. I mean, I'd been known him as Lil K, but when he brought that picture to me, I look at that picture every day. And I can't think but think of Lil K. And the song, I listen to it every day. So we're connected some kind of way. It's all a connection. But the thing is, not only did that, he always shows up to console you. Just like he popped up at my house when my son lost his mother. That was just last year. See, I'm seeing how this kid, and he was there. And he had a time, a little moment to sit down. I like, you know, I'm a gamer. I like, come on, Lil K, let's play the game. So we played 2K. So I beat him, of course. But we played again, and it was a tie. And so he said, so I left and came back in the living room. He said, okay, come on, Mom. I like, wait. We played blacktop. He made the whole team. He made my team. He made his team. But it's just the thing, when these kids got time to sit down, and they can sit down sometimes, you got to just chill. You know, that's time you can talk to them. I asked him how his grandparents was doing. I asked him how his mom was doing because she had got shot. And I'm like, how your mom doing? She all right. Then, you know, we talked a little. I don't want to, you know, get into that because, you know, I'm the mom away from the mom. You know what I'm saying? These kids, they when they been out in the street, some of the kids' moms care too. I cared about Lil K. My son's name was Dunk. So if you know who I'm talking about, you know me. Lil K and Dunk. And dude, I'm telling you, I seen them grow up. So, you know, you're gonna get through this. You know, once I called you, I talked to you. And as soon as she answered the phone, she just cried, and I felt it. And then Josh came over to my house the other day, and I didn't know who he was at first. And he said, I'm his brother, because that's how they say it. And I'm like, oh my God, come here. And he gave me the warmest hug, and I'm like, we're going to get through this. And I say, you know, it's crazy because it's connection, you know. So we just got to be there for each other. When these kids got time to sit down, let's talk to them. The thing is, we so church is not open. You know, when my son got killed, I didn't have a chance to go to a church yet. You just don't know how bad I want to go to a church and talk to God and ask him. But the pandemic, everything, we don't have time. So we have time to be in the house. You know, kids have time to think. And it's just a lot. So when they does that time, let's talk to them. Let's see what's going on with them. Because we got a lot more kids left. And you know what? They got the angels looking over. But we got to do our part down here. Let's be with our kids. Let's love them while we can. Please, y'all. Please.
Thank you so very much. Okay? Amen.
We'll have a selection from Carol Ford.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, God's amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, He's ransomed me. His mercy reigns, unending love, God's amazing grace. Now I am free. Praise the Lord, I'm free, no longer bound, no more chains holding me. My soul is resting, it's just a blessing. Praise the Lord, hallelujah, I'm free. Oh, praise the Lord, hallelujah, I'm free.
It is such an interesting thing, the way the scripture talks about being born and dying. The way it talks about birth and death. And typically what happens is we do just the opposite of what the scripture says for us to do. Because it says that, listen to this, it's weird. Weep when they're born. And then it talks about rejoicing when they die. That's different, because generally we weep when they die and we rejoice when they're born. So I want us, before I just start, to thank the Lord for Caleb's life. Can we give an applause for him today? Father, Thank you so much today for your spirit, your life, your grace, your comfort. Thank you for ministering to this family. Thank you for doing all that needs to be done, saying all that needs to be said. And we trust you in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to challenge you to do, I only have just three things I would ask you to do today during this time. And the first one is to remember. I want you to remember Caleb's life. Think about the times you've, you know, the eulogy means to speak well of. The eulogy has already been done. The eulogy, the family has done that, the friends have done that. So I'm here really not just to do a eulogy, but to help us, facilitate us during this time. And that is, I want to encourage you to remember. Remember your time with him. Remember who he was to you. Remember those special times. Remember the conversations. Remember the funny times. Remember, listen to this, even the painful times. I don't think God gave us all of these types of emotions that we are not to use them. So we are to understand that when we remember, we feel all sorts of things. And as somebody said, it is okay. The last thing I want to tell you to do is to not cry. The Bible talks about grieving, and we go through the process of grieving. But it says that we don't grieve as those who have no hope. So we understand that we do grieve. So I want you to remember Caleb's life. Remember those conversations. But also I want you to remember something else. Remember that death is certain. Death is certain. I want you to understand something. This life is brief. James chapter 4 says, why you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while, then vanishes. So I don't care how long you live in, listen to this, in the scheme of eternity, your life is brief. The other thing about life is this, and we know this, we all can testify that life is unpredictable. I don't know, you know, I'll tell you, life has a way of bringing stuff to you that you never ordered. Life has a way of bringing things to your to you, and you sit there and go, where did this come from? Life is unpredictable. That's why we have to have a guide through this life. We can't live this life alone. Other thing I want to tell you, life is brief, life is unpredictable, but this life will end. I want you to hear me. I want you to hear this. There's a scripture in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. It says, and it is appointed for men to die once, but after that, the judgment. So I don't care how you think about yourself, this life has an end to it. We don't like to talk about it. We don't want to. In fact, I'm going to go ahead and get personal. Black folk get real superstitious when we start talking about a will and all that kind of stuff because we think we're going to hasten death. You have an appointment. God knows when it is going to be. And so if life is brief, life is unpredictable. The question is this. The question is, are you prepared when it is your time? The question isn't whether you're going to die. It's, are you prepared to die? What a question. And so I told you, you have to remember Caleb, but remember the certainty of death. But the scripture tells us something else to remember. And we got a lot of young people in here, so I want to speak specifically to you. In Ecclesiastes chapter number 12, verse 1, it says, remember your creator. We can remember Caleb. We can remember that death is certain, but it says, remember your creator. Listen to this. In the days of your youth, before the difficult days come and the years draw near when you say, I have no pleasure in them. One other translation of Ecclesiastes 12:1, the New Living Translation says, don't let the excitement of youth cause you to forget your creator. Honor him in your youth before you grow old and say life is not pleasant anymore. So right now is the time that we honor the Lord. Let me tell you my own story. You know, I was brought up in the church too, Mr. B, and I said this. I said, you know, what I'm going to do, I'm going to give my life to the Lord when I get 60. I knew that there was heaven. I knew there was hell. I understood all that kind of stuff. But in my mind, I said, I'm going to give my life to the Lord when I get 60. And then I had the thoughts. It came to me just like this. And just like it said, fool, what if you don't live to be 60? And I want to let you know that God in his sovereignty and his mercy caused the conversation to happen with me and somebody else, and they began to introduce me to Jesus Christ. As a young man, I gave my life to the Lord as a teenager. And my friend, I thought, my thinking was the reason that I was going to live my, you know, wait till I get 60, because I'm going to have all my fun. I'm going to get all that out. And then I'll get prepared to meet my maker. But the thing is this, I realize that life really begins when you know God. Life begins when you know God. So I told you three simple things I want you to remember. But the next thing I want you to do, I want you to take this time to review your life. Remember and then review your life. Now, when you're talking about review your life, begin to look over the landscape of your life and ask some serious questions. Dr. Miles Monroe said that there are five key questions that every person needs to ask. The first one is, who am I? It's a question of identity. Who am I? Really, who are you? Not who everybody else think you are. But who are you? The next question is, where did I come from? That's a question of source. You didn't just show up. You came from somewhere. And then the next question is a question of purpose. Why am I here? Why am I here? But then you have to ask another question. What can I do? That's potential. And the last question is, where am I going? That's a question of destiny. Who am I? Where did I come from? Why am I here? What can I do? And where am I going? My friend, if you would wrestle with those questions as you review your life, you'll discover something. You'll discover that what Dr. Miles Monroe said was true. He said, the greatest tragedy in life is not death. There's something worse than death. The greatest tragedy is life without purpose. You got breath and you don't even know why you have it. You've got gifts, you don't know why you have it. You got talent, you don't know why you have them. You got friends and relationships, you don't know why you have it. What is the purpose? What is your purpose? And so my question is, are you wasting your life or are you living your life on purpose? Have you caught a hold of the very reason that you are here today? Your life means something. You're not an accident. You're not just a thought because your mom and daddy decide to have a good time. But you are here because Almighty God thought that it was necessary that you be in the earth at this time to fulfill his purpose. In fact, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, that same book says, to everything, there's a season. A time for every purpose under heaven. And so, my friend, you only have a season to fulfill that purpose. I want you to go ahead and get busy understanding what the purpose is, understanding how you need to walk that out, because your life matters. Your life counts. God did not have, listen, when he created you, he had something in mind. Why not ask him, God, what did you have in mind? Why is it that I like this, or I'm attracted to this, or what's going on with me? And you'll begin to discover some things that Almighty God pre-wired you for to do. So I want to encourage you that you got to make your life count. I told you, you need to remember. You need to review. But I believe this is it. Now it's time to refocus. One of the gentlemen came up earlier. He talked about how this COVID situation, all of the things that's happened in 2020, 2021. Folks, we've not been this way before. And so it's time to make some changes. It's time to make some changes. It's time to make some different choices. You can't keep on making the same old choices and expecting different results. You can't just keep on going and expect that something different is going to happen. I got to make some changes. And you got to tell yourself that. Have the courage to make some changes. Have the courage to make some different choices. It amazes me how we all say, I'm my own person, I'm an individual, but yet we stand five of us up right next to each other, we all look alike. You are a copy. Why be a copy when you can be an original? At best, you'll be a cheap copy. But when you're talking about what's best, is to become that original. Refocus your time. The writer of Ecclesiastes, who said for us to remember our Creator in chapter 12, he ended the whole book by saying this. He said, let us hear the conclusion of the matter in Ecclesiastes 12, verse 13. He said, fear God, keep his commandments, for this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. The New Living Translation of Ecclesiastes 12:13 says, that's the whole story. Here now is my final conclusion. Fear God and obey his commands, for this is everyone's duty. God will judge us for everything we do, including every secret thing, whether good or bad. So I want to encourage you, don't try to operate your life with God on the outside of it, and then you use him like you call 911. Emergency access only. Why not bring him in? This is what I found out. God can handle you. He can handle everything that's going on the inside of you. I'm talking about when you don't know what to pray. Don't try to pray like other folks pray. You talk to God from the depths of your heart. God, I'm angry. I don't know what's going on with me. I need you to fix some things on the inside of me. Oh God, I don't understand why I keep being attracted to the same old stupid stuff. I need you to intervene in my life. And my friend, that's part of the refocusing. So remember, take some time to review, but don't leave it there. Go ahead and refocus your life. Change the trajectory so that you'll end up in a different place. Your future is ahead of you, and greater things are ahead of you than you can ever imagine. But God did not factor himself out of it. He factored himself in it. He said, Pastor, how do I do that? You simply invite him into your heart. Don't stop right now. Don't get religious on me. Because when I say invite him into your heart, some of us have already preconceived what that means. We've been around church and we've seen a little bit of it on TV. What I'm talking about is you bring the real you to a real God who can handle your real life in a real way. Are you hearing me? I'm talking about where you are finally open and honest with God and saying, God, I need you. And then this is what I found out. Elder Ron read the scripture, talks about nothing can separate us from his love. And then he began to list all of those things. I don't care what's going on, what you've done, what you've been into, what you've been involved with. It does not matter. It never stopped God from loving you. Amen. Honestly, I don't get it. Because I understand love. If you do me right, I do you right. You do me wrong. But I understand that God's not like that. He loves us, he cares for us, and he wants to be a part of our life. I want to challenge you right now. Would you do something courageous? Would you have the courage to say, I'm ready to make a difference. I'm ready to make a change in my life. And you said, Pastor, how do I do that? And I told you, Jesus is the one who can make the transformation real in your life. Would you bow your heads with me, please? Every eye closed, every head bowed. And I want to ask you to pray this prayer with me. But you've got to provide the sincerity of heart. I'm going to give you words, and you can invite him into your heart right now. Because you've got to answer those questions. That last question being, where am I going? Come on, just pray it with me out loud. Say, Dear Jesus, I bring my life to you, recognizing that you, oh God, are my source. I'm tired of making the wrong choices. I'm asking you now, please give me a new start. Forgive me of my sin. Come into my heart. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. In Jesus' name. With every head still bowed, please, every eye closed. If you prayed that prayer for the first time and you meant it, for the first time you prayed and asked Jesus to come into your heart, with every head bowed, every eye closed, would you simply raise your hand right where you are? Pastor, I prayed that prayer for the first time. I see that hand. 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 I see hands all across this room. You can put those hands down now. You can look up at me because I want to say welcome to the family of God. Welcome to the family of God. Now listen to me. Let me give you some instructions. When you give your life to God, what happens is this. The Bible calls it you are born again. Born again. Now listen, anything that's born is born a baby. And every mama said, thank you, God. When it's born a baby, it needs to be nourished. The baby needs to grow. So in other words, you are born spiritually, but you're spiritually a baby and you have to grow. So how do you grow? You grow through the word of God. You grow through inner relationships with other believers, other Christians. You grow through your prayer. You grow. So I want to encourage you, nurture your spiritual life. Hey, if you're around here, I'd love to see you at our church right here. But wherever you are, please make that happen. Mr. B already said, you can call us. You can call him. Get in contact. Tell somebody, listen, I just gave my heart to Jesus. And I want to tell you, your life will never be the same again. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you so much for the Bowden family. I pray now in the name of Jesus for your comfort for this family. Thank you for every person today who gave their lives to you, who prayed that prayer. I'm asking you by the power of your Holy Spirit to do a work on the inside of them where the word would begin to just take root and they grow in their relationship with you. Bring somebody across their path to help them nurture and nourish their faith. And I thank you for it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 We are going to do a prayer of committal here in the sanctuary. And following the prayer of committal, I'll do a closing prayer of committal in closing. And then I'm going to ask the Willie Watkins Funeral Home to come. And what's going to happen after that is this. We will we'll have a recessional where the family will begin to leave. I know we want to greet and all that, but we're going to be under the direction of the funeral home, and so they will come after I finish. I'm going to ask that we all stand, and I'm going to ask the funeral directors to come, please. For as much as it has pleased Almighty God in his wise providence to take out of this world the soul of our deceased brother, we therefore commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust, looking for the general resurrection in the last day and the life of the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose second coming is glorious majesty to judge the world, the earth, and the dead, and the sea shall give up the dead, and the corruptible bodies of those who sleep in him shall be changed and be made unto his glorious body, according to the mighty working whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write, from henceforth blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so saith the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. I'm going to ask that we repeat the Lord's Prayer in unison, please. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Father, as we leave this place today, I thank you for your peace, your protection, your provision. More than anything else, your presence. May the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us all, both now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen.
Mr. Michael, you may have a seat. Be seated, please. I'll first give an honor to God and to Pastor Johnson. Pastor Johnson, let me just say to the family, have to say thank you for your consoling word. What you have said to console this family, the family simply say thank you. My prayer is that they heard the word and that they know that they in turn will hear to the word and do as you said, do. Because it is dangerous out here now, and we have to look to see what has happened with ourselves when we start looking at each other. Because we're fighting an unknown element, but it's all in God's hands. That way, we have to always trust God. To the many friends who gather, the family have us not. Sir, friends, don't walk out. I told y'all, we got to get a family respect. Let's get a family respect. And we in the church. We're not in the club. To the many friends who gather, the family have acknowledged to you their appreciation for you coming, share it in the passing one. Whatever you're doing, card, flower, or just said a prayer. Your presence here means so much to this family. To this lovely family, on behalf of myself and staff, we take this time out to acknowledge to you our appreciation for you chose to be in your funeral council during your hour of bereavement. And in doing so, we prepare the memorial plaque for you to keep it cheerful. We'll get one for you, all right? You got him there. That's good. Keep him in your heart. That way he'll never die. Always speaking. Just before they start, let me have the Paul brothers come, please. Christopher Britton, Anthony Fields, Ronald Matthews, Elijah Shepherd, Joshua Shepherd, Andre William. Are you all here? Are those names on the program? Are you here? I need y'all to come over here, please. Thank you.
Thank you.